All right,
we have our group 3 students joining us. I'm happy to see that the judges are all here. Let's place the judges on top, please. Could I have, no, missing is in the second row. Could you can place me, Newton. Okay, so let's go ahead with group 3. Welcome to the competition, children. So good to see all of you. I'm going to just name all of you. Please correct me if I have mispronounced your name. And there goes the first tongue twister. Chingalemba Topkam.
Yes, ma'am. It's correct, ma'am.
I hope I got it right.
Yes, ma'am. It's Chingalemba Topkam.
Great, great. Neil Joshi, Neha Jain, Nishka Milkhelkar.
It's Mirkhelkar.
Come again?
It's Mirkhelkar.
Mirkhelkar.
Yeah.
M-I-R, right? So
yes, ma'am.
There's been a spelling error over here. Thank you for pointing it out, Nishka. All right. Zaira? Zaira Sheikh?
It's actually pronounced as Zara.
Zara? Okay. Thank you. All right. Students, I'd like to tell you that you are going to be judged on 4 parameters: content, confidence, communication, and the response to the questions that your jurists will be posing to you. Should we go ahead?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Great. All right. Chingalemba Topkam, who's joining us from Himachal Pradesh, is our first participant. Chingalemba, I'm going to request Ms. Uttara Singh to allot you a topic and take this forward. Ms. Singh, please go ahead.
Namaste to you. Chingalemba, would you please introduce yourself to us?
Warm greetings to everyone. My name is Chingalemba Topkam. I'm from Manipur, Imphal West District. Currently, I'm studying in Lawrence School, Sanawar, Himachal Pradesh, pursuing my science stream. Previously, I was studying in Nira High School, Panchgani, Maharashtra. My personal hobbies are reading, playing basketball, and drawing. I'm now 16-year-old, pursuing to change the society for the betterment. Thank you.
Wonderful. So your topic is a cultural shift to nurture creativity, from being part of the problem to being part of the solution.
Yes, ma'am. Can I beg your pardon?
Should I repeat it?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So basically, from being part of the problem to being part of the solution.
Ma'am, I didn't get the first part. I couldn't hear clearly.
All right, I'll repeat. My question for you, Chingalemba, is a cultural shift to nurture creativity from being part of the problem to being part of the solution.
Yes, ma'am. So I believe that our present culture is new and modern. So I think that we should evolve our culture from traditional methods to new modern ones so that we can improve our creativity. For example, like now currently we are facing the problem of online classes. So traditionally we used to go to school and we used to meet our teachers there and physically present in the class and we used to listen to the teachers. But now as the present crisis is happening, we should change our traditional culture. Like we should get creative. We should try to be like properly present in the online classes and not bunk it or something. And we should always be ready to take changes and evolve ourselves, not only like the current surrounding and not only the planet should evolve, but our culture also should evolve. Like, for example, we used to have agricultural methods like traditional ones. We used to use hoe and axe and pick, but now we have evolved to such as tractor using machines, and we can produce more farm goods. So like that, we should also evolve culturally. We should try to get our minds diversely thinking, and we should always find new culture, then try to experiment on different cultures. If something is bad, we can always go for the good ones. And as we get experience, we'll get to know like which is better. So I believe that we should always try on new things, as well as keep in knowledge and notes about like our past experience. And that's all I can say.
All right, fine. So Chingalamba, if you were a team leader, okay, and you had to find a solution to a complex problem, what would be your focus on? Would you use creativity or would you bank on experience?
Ma'am, it's in my opinion, it's like more of experience, as experience never tells you the wrong thing. For example, our creativity may be extraordinarily good, but sometimes it can lead us to like misfortune. Sometimes we can fail without creativity, but I don't want that to happen, as because I'm a part of a team and I can't just think that if I fail, it's okay, I will do it again. But it's about my team. I should care for my teammates, and always we should, our comrades are relying on us, so we should never break their trust. And I think experience would be very good so that our team has a higher rate of success.
All right. Well done.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Chingalamba. And thank you, Ms. Singh. Let's move on to our participant number two, Neil Joshi, who's joining us from Mumbai. Dr. Raman Charla, please go ahead and allot a topic to Neil.
Neil, can you introduce yourself in about a minute?
Yes, sir. So my name is Neil Joshi and I'm currently studying at Bombay Scottish School, Mahim in Mumbai. I'd firstly like to thank the Lead India Celebration hosts for giving me this opportunity to represent myself in the grand finale. I would never in a million years have thought that I would get such a good opportunity. I'm currently studying in the humanities section at my school and wish to pursue an undergraduate degree in economics and a postgraduate degree in environmental policy making, because I believe that climate change is the biggest threat to my generation, and it is up to my generation as to how we solve it. My hobbies include doing Model United Nations, reading and writing about climate change, swimming, and my favorite pastime is reading books. A couple of friends of mine and I have also started our own blog where we review art, movie, books, etc. Don't tell anyone this, but this is actually just a good way for me to watch more movies.
Okay. Yeah. Neil, so here is a topic for you. That is people in policy, courage versus fear. Yeah, go ahead.
Yes, the medicine is harsh, but the patient requires it in order to live. Should we withhold the medicine? No. This quote was said by the revolutionary Margaret Thatcher, the first female prime minister of the United Kingdom. Margaret Thatcher was characterized by her decisiveness and no-nonsense attitude. Climbing up the political ladder, she had the vision of herself as the prime minister, not for the fame or glory, but because she knew she could make a change. And make a change she did. Her political legacy is known for the policies she employed based on her convictions for a better UK. She did not think of the public sentiment. She had faith that Britain required strong policies that would help the country in the long run. I bring up Margaret Thatcher here because she is one of the few examples in modern politics who had core principles and solemnly stood by them. Every political issue is a double-sided coin with large factions supporting both sides. It is a policymaker's role to strike that delicate balance between these two factions and to fashion a policy that would best suit the country. This often requires policymakers to implement policies that may not agree with some people, but are for the larger benefit of the country. We need policies that propel the country forward, not just policies that garner policymakers' votes. Therefore, the question of courage and fear in policymaking is a pertinent one. We value and even admire people who work hard and play by the rules. But leadership requires something more. Leaders take on the problems of others and are willing to risk ridicule, derision, and even the loss of position or reputation to solve those problems. That generally means disrupting a system wherein some current winners may even become losers. There will be resistance by people who benefit from the established system and have the capacity to inflict nuisance. But that is what sets leaders and policymakers apart from ordinary civilians. Courage to fight for what is right. Courage to know that in politics, never does everyone end up a winner. Courage to take a risk. Fear itself is a frightening force. It is a natural force that can flood through us and make us incapable of reacting. We stop in our tracks when we fear what people will say, what will happen as a consequence of fear, the pain of loss.
I'm so sorry to have intervened, but you have exceeded the time limit. You spoke
Can I just say some concluding remarks then?
All right.
If every person in policy would have thought of what people might say, Martin Luther King Jr. would have never been able to fight for civil rights. Narasimha Rao could have never liberalized the Indian economy. If this was the right decision or not, I do not want to enter that debate. Simply that it was a courageous one. Finally, as Martin Luther King said, we must build dikes of courage to hold back the flood of fear. Thank you.
Yeah, Neil, I have a quick question for you.
Yes, sir.
What is the most debated policy in recent times?
One of the most debated policies is definitely the GST implemented by our government. It definitely has its pros and cons, such the pros being that it has united all taxes. We don't have various taxes for various things, which streamlines businesses. But the GST has also had negative impact on MSME businesses. So that's why it's currently a largely debated policy that was implemented. Another one was also demonetization, because of course it got a lot of black money out of our society today, but it also again set back a lot of small and medium-sized enterprises because people didn't have cash to pay those entrepreneurs.
Yeah, thanks, Neil.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Neil. Neha Jain is our third participant. She's joining us from Delhi. Mr. Panisetti, please go ahead.
Hey, Neha, how are you?
I'm great. What about you?
I'm good. So if you can do 1 minute introduction, then I'll give you a topic after that.
Sure, sir. I'm Neha Jain, a girl with vision in my eyes, an ambition to touch the skies and conquer the world with a smile. Yes, this is me. And I must say that indeed, as an individual, lockdown has helped me to discover myself and grow each day. I currently study in class 12 at Salvan Public School, New Delhi. I aim to go for civil services to serve my nation and humanity as a whole. My family and teachers have been a constant source of inspiration in my life. I've been learning classical dance and I'm passionate about psychology as a subject. Yoga, reading, travel blogging, and poetry are some of my hobbies. I've also got the opportunity to seek knowledge from His Holiness Dalai Lama during an interaction and perform yoga at national level. Vidya Param Balam, and I strongly believe education is the supreme power, therefore I've been volunteering to teach young children to do my bit for the society. Thus, I, as an aspiring international ambassador, would like to appeal all the stakeholders to come together not only for battling novel coronavirus, but also the archaic mental virus of ignorance to transform commerce-based culture into a knowledge-based culture. Last but not the least, I look forward to make the most of this celebration and use my voice to inspire others. Thank you.
Very nice, Neha. For the future international ambassador, I have a topic for you. Technology for evolution like versus technology for devolution. That is like addiction and abuse.
Yes, sir. So technology, I believe, is a weapon to which can break and make the world. It can change the world for the positive and for the negative as well. Today we are seeing that in these COVID-19 pandemic times, we've seen that there have been technological innovations. As they say that the need is mother of invention. And today, as we are coming across various challenges, we have seen various technological innovations. And we see emerging AI technologies, IoT, global computing. And this is what has brought us together. Indeed, technology is a medium through which today we are together and able to celebrate this occasion. So again, there are two sides of a coin, but it depends on which side we are. On one hand, there are the people are using technology for purposes like drug trafficking through dark web and using various unacceptable means of technology for their self-interest and greed. And that is what we need to fight. We need to fight this commerce-based culture, and we need to move towards knowledge-based culture. We need to use technology for enhancing knowledge and develop our minds and incorporate independent thinking in students like us who will be torchbearers in the world. And I would just like to end by a quote. So it says that parindo ko manzil milegi yakeenan. Parindo ko manzil milegi yakeenan. Ye unke phele hue par bolte hain. Ye unke phele hue par bolte hain. Zamane mein aksar wo log khamosh rehte hain jinke hunar bolte hain. So today we need to fight and we need to come forward and bring a positive difference in the world. Thank you.
Nice. Thank you. So you mentioned, you talked about different areas of technology and you mentioned artificial intelligence. So what has been one thing in the recent past, what has fascinated you from a technology perspective, evolution wise?
So technology has always been so fascinating and bringing out different perspectives in our lives. And as just talked about AI. So as a student, I participated in a competition. It was an AI-based competition. And there we got to learn that AI could be used for a lot. There are conventional techniques of using AI, and it is being used through chatbots, through various other mechanisms. But how AI can bridge the differences in society and how we can help society through that and bring out unconventional techniques of using the same pedagogy. So that is what fascinates me and uncovers something new every day about technology.
Very nice. Thanks, Neha.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, Neha. Thank you, Mr. Panicetti. Let's now go across to participant number 4. Nishka Mirkelkar, who's joining us from Atlanta in the United States. Ms. Uttara Singh, please go ahead and allot a topic.
So, Nishka, would you please introduce yourself to us in a minute?
Yes, absolutely. So, my name is Nishka Mirkelkar, and I'm currently in 11th grade, and I go to Wheeler High School, and I'm part of their magnet program, which focuses on math and science. And I really love studying, and my favorite subjects are math and language arts. I love math because it teaches me perseverance and not to give up, because every single problem in math has a solution. And no matter how many times I have to redo a problem, I keep doing it because I know there's an answer. And I love language arts because I love working with words. It's so fun for me to write essays and see how well words can impact people if it's used in a good way, and how it can also impact people if it's used negatively. So I have a lot of hobbies as well. I do dance, and I do Indian classical dance called Bharatanatyam. And last year I did come down to India and I completed my engagement there. And that was a very unique journey for me because I had never done something that required so much rigor and pain and like effort to do well. I'm also a black belt, and I have a first degree, and I've been doing I've been doing martial arts in the form of Taekwondo for nearly 6 to 7 years. And that was also its own unique journey that taught me many things, such as value, discipline, which is the foundations of martial arts, to use your gift of fighting for good. And then I also play the violin. I play both Western and Carnatic violin for a couple years, and I really enjoy those passions, and it gives me a way to express myself through music. And I'm really excited to see what I can do to spread my message.
Wonderful. Nishka, you're doing a lot, I must say. Dance, music, black belt. God bless you, and more power to you, young lady. So the theme for you is the road ahead, the road ahead for humanity, knowledge-based culture versus a commerce-based culture.
Okay. So knowledge-based culture is applied in organizations, but can also be applied in society and such as schools. Knowledge-based culture is when people focus on gaining intellect. It's the mental gains. It's trying to learn information and using these informations as a competitive advantage against other organizations or using it to better yourself. So when I think of knowledge-based cultures or jobs that require knowledge-based cultures, I think of professions such as doctors, IT, computer science, because these fields are requiring people to constantly do research, reading, to keep working. And without the knowledge or gaining of more information, these fields can't go forward. And I think it's really important to think of knowledge-based culture as a culture where the main focal point is to get as much information as possible so that we can create a progressive society. So the best way I can put knowledge-based culture in like perspective for maybe younger audiences to understand is thinking about trivia games, like games that require you to get more knowledge for you to succeed and do better in them. And that's how I would put it in perspective, games that have different levels of intellect for you to do and gain more knowledge on. Commerce-based culture is focused on money gains. It's more mostly focused on trade, like exporting, importing. It's not focused as much on knowledge because you're focusing on how to get money into organizations and how to help them, the organization, get a competitive advantage through that aspect. And to think of commerce-based culture, I would say it's more of a money gain. You want to gain money, whereas knowledge-based culture is focused more on the mental gains of an individual. So if I talk about commerce-based culture in the form of a game, I would say it's the classic game I'm sure all of us have played at one point in our lives. It's called Monopoly. You trade, you build houses, you trade with people, you have to buy land. And the whole point of that game is to be able to collect as much money as possible and to be able to invest in different lands. And that's pretty much how I view commerce-based culture. But I will say, for commerce-based culture to properly succeed, it does need some knowledge, because it's not easy to make good trades, to have good international relations without having some knowledge. So I think it's really important to note that these two may be very different, but they do have some similarities, and they both are helping society progress in their own unique way.
All right. So tell me that going ahead after this entire pandemic and the way, you know, the economy of the world has been impacted and affected, and also the way knowledge is available to all of us at the click of a button today, what do you see gaining more importance in the world, let's say, 10 to 20 years down the line, a knowledge-based culture or a commerce-based culture, and why?
Okay, so in my personal opinion, I do feel like knowledge is key, knowledge is power. And without having knowledge, it's not possible in 20 to 30 years for the planet to still be alive. If people are not aware of situations like global warming, and with the devices in front of our hands, especially when there was the Lebanon explosion, within days people were able to find out about it. And there were many online donations that people could give to help the people out there. So by having more knowledge and being able to use the knowledge in the correct way, it's able to help people. And I definitely see that in the future, if we focus more on knowledge and have more of a knowledge-based culture, it's definitely helping society more. I'm not saying commerce-based culture isn't needed, because obviously to have international affairs and stuff, we need to have trade and other things with countries, but knowledge-based is definitely far more significant for society to go ahead.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
To be some broadcast issue, just hold on. All right. Thank you, Nishka. Thank you. Well spoken. Let's now go to our fifth and final participant, Zahra. Zahra Sheikh, who's joining us from Guwahati. I hope I pronounced your name correct. Isn't that Zahra?
Zahra, actually.
Zahra?
Yeah.
All right. I probably got it wrong now. I'm sorry. I'll come again and I'll introduce you again. All right, let's come to our fifth and final participant, Zahra Sheikh, who's joining us from Guwahati at this hour. While Dr. Raman Charla can perhaps allot a topic to Zahra, I think Mr. Panisetti can take a question from Zahra.
Hi, Zahra. Yeah, can you introduce yourself in about a minute?
Yeah, sure. Hello everyone, my name is Zahra Sheikh and I'm 17 years old. I'm currently pursuing my final year of high school from Marias Public School in the science department. Growing up, I always enjoyed the silent company of books, and that habit just transitioned into my teenage years, giving me the confidence that I needed to become a writer and a poet. I have participated in many literary events in regional, national and international level with organizations such as Trinity College London, Science Olympiad Foundation, with Selby Foundation, Katha Utsav, and also as a journalist in various modern United Nations across the country. Aside from my love for literature, I'm also interested in the world of numbers and computers. I aspire to study in IIT Bombay in computer science engineering with specialization in ethical hacking and computer analysis. I'm also a trained artist and I paint and draw whenever I can. Aside from that, I would describe myself as a leader in various aspects, and I have led many food donation drives, many animal protection drives across my community. I absolutely adore animals, and I have rescued around 25 of them till date, including stray cats, dogs, goats, even a cow, and a little monkey named Kiki. So I'm always on the lookout for new and different things, and this is so I look forward to this session with all of you. It's a pleasure to make your acquaintance.
Yeah. So, Zahra, here is a topic for you, that is belief-based society versus independent thinking society. Yeah, and merits and demerits.
All right, sure. So, a belief-based society works on the principle of traditional values and ethics, while an independent thinking society keeps evolving and changing its definition according to the individual's presence. The pros of a belief-based society as opposed to an independent thinking society are, firstly, solidarity. People belonging to a particular religion or belief closely identify themselves within the group members. Secondly, the one more pro is their ethical values. Religion helps in the development of ethical values, for example, caring for your parents, protection of small children, helping the poor or disabled, and serving values like honesty. Now coming to the cons of a belief-based society as opposed to an independent thinking society, firstly, it forms a feeling of groupism. I believe that religion and belief divides people as much as it makes people come together. Such divisions may come in the way of development of the country. So people belonging to different religions feel that their religion is superior or their belief is superior. So they might even try to impose their religious practices on others, which would lead to conflict situations. In India, communal conflicts have become common features. Secondly, one more form of a belief-based society is its dogmatism. So I believe that every religion has a certain set of beliefs which might be superstitious quite often. So such ideas block the development of society and the progress of individuals. For example, in some communities, there are no improvement in the status of women or the lower class people on account of religious attitudes. Thirdly, it blocks social change. Religion or belief, too much of religion or belief, I feel, acts as a hindrance for social change. It's highly challenging to transform the attitude of conservative people, for example, restrictions on marriage or women's rights, etc. For the sake of a better argument, I would prefer an independent society over a belief-based society for the reasons that religion and personal beliefs should not be integrated into the generalized definition of a society. Instead, different religions should be respected by celebrating the individualism and beautiful practices. So that's where I lie on this topic, belief-based society versus independence-based thinking society. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks, Zara.
So Zara, yes. So Zara, thanks for that on both the areas. So if it's a hypothetical situation, like let's say you are, you know, you're supposed to live in a very restricted belief-based society, where women are suppressed. So what would you do, being part of that community? What would be the three things? How you survive there, and how would you change things there?
All right, great question. Thank you for asking that. I believe my first step would obviously be to speak out against all the discrimination or the atrocities that are committed on women or any other group or minor group in the society. Doing that, I feel, would obviously make me very weak to a certain scrutiny from the society itself, because that would put me in a very dangerous position. But as far as I am concerned, that is all right. If I am making a whole new movement of women and the other minor groups to stand up and raise their voice together. So I think, yeah, that's where I stand on this topic.
Thanks, Zara.
Thank you very much.
Zara, thank you. Thank you all, to all our students for participating in today's competition. And I must tell all of you that you spoke phenomenally. You were outstanding. And we will be announcing the winner on the show later. But having said that, that doesn't mean that any of you were any less. All of you were great. And I think the judges and I have just been marveling at the fact that your generation is way ahead of time, and we are so proud to have all of you on the show tonight.